Hello, firearms friends. Joel Colander here again with Rock Island Auction for another episode of Guncovered. Guncovered is where we take a more informal look than some of our more polished videos because, by gosh, there's just something cool enough in an auction and we really feel the need to tell you about it. And, well, maybe there just wasn't enough time to give it a typical video that you see on our channel. So today we're going to talk about one of the guns in our February Sporting and Collector auction. That's coming up February 3rd through 6th. Catalog is posted right now on rockislandauction.com. It's over 5,000 lots. There are nearly 5,000 lots. There's over 8,700 guns. So we're starting off 2020 on the right foot. But let's get back to the guns. The gun I want to talk to you about today is a pretty rare one, especially to see it in a sporting and collector's sale. Now, you might think it looks like from there, a regular model 1903. I am pleased to tell you that this is an unconverted 1903, and you can start to tell the tale there with its rod bayonet. But before we can tell you about the model 1903, we got to tell you kind of how it came to be. And for that, we'll take one step back as far as U.S. service rifles go for the Krag Jørgensen. Now, the Krag's a very serviceable rifle, and for those who have handled one and who know, boy, they're really well made. They're really well put together. They are smooth, and there's nothing wrong with these. In fact, you can see when you put a 1903 next to a Krag Jørgensen, you can see a lot of the carryover and why the government wanted to carry over from the Krag to the 1903. That said, in the Spanish-American War, they did have their shortcomings, and mainly those shortcomings were discovered against the 7mm Spanish Mausers. Now, the 7mm Mausers, that's their 7x57mm cartridge, which provided a very fast, very flat shooting round for the Spanish. Now, those characteristics of the 7mm Mauser earned that round the nickname the Spanish Hornet from U.S. troops. Now, they had their serviceable Krag rifles, very, as we mentioned, very well put together, very underrated as far as, in my humble opinion, as a U.S. military service rifle, but they were outclassed. You weren't able to load them as fast through the side loading gate as you could with the Spanish stripper clips, and then, of course, you had the 30-40 Krag cartridge. That's, of course, a 30 caliber projectile, 40 grains of smokeless powder. It was, by the way, the first smokeless powder rifle cartridge for the U.S. military, at least smokeless as designed from the ground up. And it had its shortcomings. You're talking a 220 grain jacketed projectile traveling at about 2,000 feet per second, far outclassed by those being fired by the Spanish. So the U.S. military knew towards the turn of the century that it needed a new rifle, something that could compete with these flat-shooting cartridges that were so popular at the time. And so they started designing a rifle from the ground up, and that's where we see some of the development that's so well covered in books like the likes of Brophy's book, Canfield's book. Boy, if you want the details, those gentlemen have done some outstanding scholarship, and we recommend those highly. Now, first of all, I do think it's fun to see that it's truly the rifles revolving around the cartridge. Like, it's the need for a better cartridge that's truly driving the development of a new rifle. And, of course, you'll see that in the Springfield Model 1901, Model 1902, and, of course, we land on the Model 1903. Its cartridges followed much of the same development. There was actually, now we know what they landed on, is the 30-06. What a lot of people don't know is there were cartridges previous to that, especially through through the 1903. We had a 30-01 or a 30-01, getting away from some of the previous round naming nomenclature and now putting the year of development on instead of how many grains of powder were included in that cartridge. So you had a 30-01. But when the rifle was developed, finished being developed in 1903, they were chambered originally in 30-03 or 30-03. That would be a 30 caliber projectile with 45 grains of powder, so a little more oomph than what we saw with the Krag. They were, however, a round nose bullet. But the 30-03 round was still a 220 grain bullet and traveling at 2,400 feet per second. So you've seen a noticeable increase in the velocity of the cartridge, but it carry over largely from the Krag in terms of bullet weight. And the 30-03 round is what brings us to this rifle here today. This is a model of 1903 as it would have in its original configuration, and we'll get to that in a second. So the original model 1903s, most noticeably, they have a rod bayonet instead of being fitted for the model 1905 bayonet. And there's a lot of other features that we'll cover in just a moment. Because obviously, as we all know, the 30-03 cartridge was not all it was cracked up to be. To generate that heavy of a bullet going that fast, there were incredible pressures being generated, pressures that were eroding the bore of the rifle, and frankly, they were just really, really hard on the guns. So the Model 1903, as it was introduced, had some flaws, to say the least. One, as we've covered, was the 30-03 cartridge, which was hard on the guns and not very flat shooting at all. It had a pretty atrocious trajectory by a lot of accounts. And it also had a rod bayonet, which we got away from the Springfield trapdoors. And in the Krag saw a regular bayonet, and for some reason they came back to the rod bayonet. Even Brophy and Canfield's book don't really speculate as to why that might have been. But there needed to be changes. And the first one, of course, came around in 1905 when Teddy Roosevelt saw the rod bayonet and decried it for how terrible and thin and flimsy it was. In fact, there is one account of Crozier holding up a rod bayonet and Teddy Roosevelt taking a standard bayonet attached to a rifle and smacking it and smashing the rod bayonet. And that was kind of the end of the demonstration. Everyone said, okay, Teddy, we get you. He also has a fantastic quote about being like one of the worst inventions he has ever seen. Grossly paraphrased, of course, but the sentiment is the same. So 1905, these rifles were called back to be retrofitted with the 1905 bayonet, which involved, of course, a shortening of the handguard. You're taking out the rod bayonet. You're putting in a new bayonet lug. There's a lot of changes happening in 1905, 1904 for those to be fixed. Unfortunately, the issue of the ammunition had not yet been solved. And as this is being developed, you're getting closer to 1906. And by 1906, of course, we all know they have the 30-06 cartridge. That's the 150-grain projectile spitzer bullet, which is, of course, traveling much flatter and much faster than the 30-03. And so after the rod bayonets have been changed out and the guns are starting to go back out, all the guns are then called back in again to be retrofitted for the 30-06 cartridge. And it's no small undertaking. The changes that had to happen to this gun were pretty immense. The barrels had to be removed. They had to be rechambered for the shorter cartridge, the shorter brass of the 30-06. You're changing rear sights. You're changing where the rear sights mount. You're changing, of course, well, the front end has already been changed by the bayonets. Any number of smaller changes. The Model 1903s were far from a finished product at this point. And long story short, there's about 70,000 Model 1903s made with the rod bayonet in this original conversion before the cry went out to go, you know, convert these things. Most, of course, were converted. They saw they were converted back at arsenals, which is why you don't see a lot of rod bayonets. Now, even though there were about 75,000 produced, there are only estimated 50 to 100 rod bayonet M1903s in their original configuration that exists today, either in private institutions or with collectors. So they are a very, very rare bird, whether you're a Springfield collector, whether you're a U.S. military collector, whether you're a U.S. Long Arms collector very specifically. It's a rare bird to have in your collection. And so here we have one in the February Sporting and Collector Auction. And it has a lot of the great features you want to see on an unconverted M1903, so a 30-03. You see we have the old rear sight. It's got some of that great script on it, which if you've seen early 1903s in the serial number, you know what those sort of scripted numerals look like. Of course, we have the rod bayonet up front. We have the lightened experimental front sight, and even the changes that aren't as apparent, like the smooth rear butt plate. We do have the flat edge that you want to see on the front stacking swivel. So a lot of those characteristics, they're all right here. So it's a rare gun. It's got a lot of the qualities that you want to see, but perhaps best of all, it's in a sporting and collector auction. So removed from our premier auctions, which are always those top of the line, world-class collectibles, here you have an insanely rare gun in some pretty darn good condition. But because it's not as pristine, you are going to find this at a much easier to find price point than you could expect at some of our premier auctions, but still a fantastic opportunity to add a very rare and somewhat lesser known piece of U.S. military history to your firearms collection. For those interested, this is lot 2771 in that February Sporting and Collector Auction. Remember, that's February 3rd through the 6th, nearly 5,000 lots, over 8,700 guns, and you can find them all right now on www.rockislandauction.com. Thanks for watching, everybody. Until next time, keep your powder dry.